First of all, by yeah, the lady, so let me just only mention connection with then most of it we had quite cooperation for for several years.
Mm-hmm.
And the title of his talk, Coverings of the Punch and Plane and Half Integral Weight Model of Force.
Thank you. So I am very glad I can congratulate Dan in person and thank the math department of giving me this opportunity. So I want to speak of half integral weight modular forms, and those are very...
Your microphone.
I have to speak louder. I just to speak louder, I think. but that's for the people who register. So half integral weight modular forms are very classical objects with the earlier hintons, I think, for weight 1/2, one has the theta function, where Q is exponential 2 pi I tau, tau in the upper half plane, and another famous 1/2 form is the eta function, with the same notion for Q, which is Q 1 over 24, product 1 minus Qn. So those are very classical objects. And my aim is to explain how half integral weight modular form can be viewed as object of algebraic geometry. The fact that it would be possible comes, for instance, from the fact that one has integral coefficient appearing, or for general half integral weight modular form for congruent subgroup, one knows that the denominator in this Q expansion are bounded, belonging to some number field, a base of some like that. And all those things can be proved with source algebraic geometry by reduction to the case of integral weight modular form, but I want to have natural understanding. And when I tell that I want to see such objects as belonging to algebraic geometry, I will recall what happens for integral weight modular form to explain what kind of model I have for what I would call an interpretation. So for integral weight, so K is some integer. Integral weight modular forms first have, for a congruent subgroup, first have analytic description. You look at function f of tau in the Poincaré upper half plane, and you want some functional equation the weight appear here in exponent, and you want some invariance. And this is for A, B, C, D in some subgroup of SL2Z, which you want to be a congruent subgroup, so containing all matrices congruent to 1 mod n for some integer. So this is the analytic description. And then there is a modular description which explains why they have a meaning in algebraic geometry. And you tell that you want a function of an elliptic curve, some omega, which is a one form on this elliptic curve, holomorphic one form, so it's the same an element of the dual of the Lie algebra, and a level structure, the n division point of the elliptic curve being identified with z mod n square. And one way of describing integral, yes, you want this. You want a condition that if you replace omega by a multiple, you multiply by lambda to the minus k, so you have weight minus k in this differential form. And now, of course, it's not just a function for, say, if I am over the complex, for each elliptic curve of the complex this, I want that this vary nicely in family. So if I have a family of elliptic curves parametrized by some algebraic variety over the complex numbers, so the fibers are the elliptic curve of the family. If I have a family of one form, yes, this one form would be non-zero. And if I have a level structure, I want to recover out of it a function on S, so a section of the structural bundle. And another way of telling this, which is slightly better, on S you have a line bundle, which is Lie algebra of the elliptic curve forming. And now, instead of telling that to E, omega, and alpha you attach a number, it's the same, and with this weight condition, it's the same to tell that of to E and alpha, simply, you attach a section on S of this, this line bundle at the tensor power minus k. And so there is a slight discrepancy, but not serious, between the two. Yes, the way to go from one point of view to the other is if you have tau here, here you have the elliptic curve, C modulo the lattice 1 and tau, and you also have the differential form dz on this elliptic curve. And possibly you would take 1 and 2 as giving a basis of the n division bounds. The discrepancy is that, depending on what condition you put, as a rule, one is interested in such form which at infinity have a reasonable behavior. So here one would allow also some compactify the moduli space of elliptic curves. And another discrepancy is that if I really want to have just a function on Poincaré upper half plane, I would fix the determinant of this alpha. Here En at the symplectic form with value in roots of unity. So this determinant of alpha makes sense as a root of unity, and I would tell which root of unity I want. But in fact, this kind of object is better. It's kind of going from SL2 to GL2, and GL2 is, as a rule, better. So you have those two descriptions of the essentially the same kind of object. And if you look at this description, it makes sense over any number field, over the integers. You can look at such rule. Of course, when I say that I want something for a family, if I take pullback by T to S of this family, I want a compatibility. So this is the sense in which modular forms have a meaning in algebraic geometry. And for this to be useful, there are a few additional things you need, not only that you have a one-to-one or a board correspondence. Two additional things you need. First is you want to be able to define Hecke operators. And for this, the basic fact is that if you have an isogeny between two elliptic curves, this gives you a map from the Lie algebra of E to the Lie algebra of E prime. And at least in characteristic zero, it is an isomorphism. And with this, you can, by summing over all p isogenies, you can define Hecke operator on forms viewed from this point of view. The other useful thing you need is a Q expansion. Here, if you look what this means for tau going to 2 plus 1, you get some periodicity, so you can expand in possibly fractional power of Q at the power 2 pi z. And a basic fact is that this makes a purely algebraic sense. The idea being the following. Over C, you can look at the elliptic curve, Z multiplicative modulo Q, Q at the power Z. And with Q and tau related in this way, C modulo 1 and tau is the same as C multiplicative modulo Q at the power Z. And now this elliptic curve makes also good sense if you work over Z double parenthesis Q. And so if you have an elliptic curve in this sense, function of families, you can apply it to this state curve and you get a Q expansion. So
this requires K to be an integer, this discussion.
Yes. So clearly, here it required it to us, I have to wonder which, what is square root of this quantity. And here one does not see, here one has lambda t power k, here one has some integral power of this line bundle. So essentially, we want some sense, but not too direct, to have a square root of this line bundle. And then it would make obvious sense what we want to do. One has to be careful. It can still make sense, but then if E is ordinary for one isogenies, you will have just an isomorphism, and for the other, you will have zero. There are a number of problems, but just one sees for them that if one has this, this proves automatically that one has a base of forms with integral or rational coefficients. Now, before telling how to go about half integral case, I would explain in classical language what is half integral weight modular form. So it's the same as this first definition, except it does not make sense. So we want a function on Poincaré per half plane. We want again something for being in a congruent subgroup. Now k is a half integer, and I have to make sense of this. The problem to make sense is to know what it means to raise this to a half integral power. Now, one way of doing it as follow. You have your A, B, C, D in SL2Z. And I will remember that SL2Z is contained in SL2R. And one has also to remember that when I see tau, I have really to think to the lattice generated by 1 and tau. And now, if I take some element of SL2R, I can get another lattice, which is the one generated by, I prefer to the tau and 1, it's the same thing, but I have I tau plus B, C tau plus D. So, starting from this lattice, having an element of SL2R, I get a new lattice. And now, if I take a continuous path, and if I take in SL2Z, I get back the same lattice. That's the reason one has some invariance. But now, if I take a continuous path from the identity to my ABCD, then I have a family of lattice starting from this one and abutting there. And I can follow this family to define any power I need of C tau plus D. For instance, a square root. So it means that if I had to take SL2R universal covering, and I take some gamma in this universal covering, it makes sense to raise it tau plus d at any power. From this additional information that, yes, so, and if I need only a square root, what I have to do is the following, is I have the double covering of SL2R, and then I have the double covering, the inverse image of SL2Z in this double covering. So I have just translated that to give a meaning to the square root of C tau plus D, I have not just to give myself gamma, but a lifting of it into double covering. So much it does not help, really, except it put it in a group theoretical framework. And now the miracle is the following, that if I look at a congruent subgroup, there is a class of lifting to the double covering with nice properties. I cannot tell a canonical lifting, I have more than one, but the basic properties are first that any two lifting agree on a possibly smaller congruent subgroup. And the second property is that if I take such a group, I can possibly go to a smaller subgroup, and I can also conjugate by anything in ZL2Q. ZL2Q acts by conjugation on SL2R, transform SL2Q into itself, and now this germ of lifting is invariant by ZL2Q. And so that's its basic property. So if I take one lifting, I conjugate it by an element of ZL2Q. It will make sense over the intersection of gamma and the conjugate of this gamma. And now the two lifting I get will agree on a possibly smaller congruent subgroup.
Do you say that exists?
Yes, and I will explain why, but essentially that's the reason that half integral weight modular form are nice objects. It makes sense to speak of an half integral weight modular form over a congruent subgroup. Like if you take other kind of fractional weight, you don't have anything like this, and things are a mess. You have no control on denominator of fractional weight automorphic form. So you have no hope of having a nice algebraic geometric understanding of them. And essentially, my aim is to explain this and to tell how one can use an understanding to get some algebraic geometry. Now, yes, so why is it so? So I have already used this double covering of SL2R, and a nice way of looking at it is as follows. You take R2 minus 0, and now you can take a double covering, non-trivial double covering. Now an element, yes. So far, I use SL2 because that's the classical framework. But from now on, I will use ZL2 systematically, which is better. So ZL2R acts on R square, minus 0 as well. And if I have an element of ZL2R, there are two ways to lift it as an action on the double covering, and this defined me a double covering of ZL2R, which acts both on R square and this double covering.
Is that an algebraic group?
No.
Huh.
And concretely, it means that here you have an element, you, if an element of GL2R, it does something, and you want to make the difference between this and this. Now, what happens is that this looks very topological. You use R2, you have a manifold. But in fact, it's a purely algebraic story. And I will take as a black box for the time being that if you had to take a vector space of dimension 2 over QP, and again you look at this vector space minus the origin, there is a natural notion of double covering of this space, which you should forget that QP is totally disconnected, and then I am just telling you there is a double covering, and this property are very similar to the one you have here. I will give a definition later, but first I want to use it as a black box. And now this definition of double covering of GL2R, you can repeat it to get a double covering of GLV. Of this double covering, GLV acts here. Each element has two lifting to the double covering, and this gives you a double covering of GLV. Ah, for a general field, you have V dimension 2 over K, V minus 0, you have a universal covering where the group of the covering is K2 of the field. And this I will have to explain. And here in this local field case, QP, there is one of the nice things, at least for P different from 2. Suppose that you choose some lattice, so ZP module of rank 2 contained in this V. And I want to remove 0, but rather than removing 0, I remove what is congruent to 0 mod P. And this I will call lambda dot. And sorry, excuse me. Sure. And now what happens for P different from 2 is that this double covering canonically splits over this lambda minus P lambda, which implies that if you take the maximal compact GL of lambda, the double covering of the group will split as well. And the next thing, suppose now you start with a vector space over Q. Oh yes, and because of this, it's now it make it possible to consider double covering of V. I start with a vector space rank dimension 2 over Q. I can look at the adelic point of this vector space containing V dot. Here I want adelic points which almost always are in such a lattice minus P times the lattice. And again, one has a notion of double covering. And essentially, one put together all the local information, and one take for each place of Q, one has a corresponding double covering, and one make the sum of those double covering to get just a double covering again. And now the miraculous thing which happens is that this double covering again splits over the Raffenhall point. And if you look now what this means for the groups, you will have the group GL2 adelic, you have a double covering. Sorry. And it splits above GL to Q canonically. Or another way of telling it, if you give yourself a vector space over Q to begin with, you can define a canonical double covering of the corresponding adelic vector space minus essentially zero together with a splitting over VQ. Yes, now a slightly different way of telling this, you GL2 adelic, it's GL2 R times GL2 finite adels, and you have a double covering of GL2 R, you have a double covering of GL2 finite adels. You want rather to consider a double covering where you divide by the diagonal Z mod 2 times Z mod 2. So it's here. But so what, and this one will split over GL2Q. So what this means is that you have two ways of seeing the double covering of GL2Q, which you are interested in. You can think to it that you view GL2Q as being contained in GL2R, and you take the inverse image in double covering of GL2R. Or you can view GL2Q as a subgroup of GL2 finite adels. You take the pullback in GL2 double covering of the finite adels, and those two double covering will be canonically isomorphic. And then it makes clear what we want to have, because if you think to this double covering of GL2Q as being contained in the double covering of the finite adels, and you know what congruent subgroups are, you take the trace of a compact open subgroup here. So this is a way to see this canonical families of lifting. And another way of telling it is that in this group, you have an orphan of a congruent subgroup, and if you which give a topology, and if you complete for this topology, and I would better use GL2, you get this double covering of GL2 finite adels. So this is to explain the meaning of those kind of privileged lifting or privileged notion of Cz plus d, of which I want to take a square root. And now I have to try to make a translation to make it geometric in terms of elliptic curves. And I first work over the complex numbers. Yes, there are two things which can be useful to tell before. One, what does it concretely mean to have a double covering of this adelic version of VA? So the way I will use it is as follows. Yes, so here what I have a vector space over Q, and I obtain a canonical double covering of VA. Uh, with a splitting over the Raffanel bonds.
What R there?
No, no, this is Q.
Oh, it's Q. Looks
yes.
Like
no, sorry. So I have, and here I have to think to it as something connected also. It serves as a base bond, on it the double covering splits. And to define a double covering, I take this as base bond to define it. So this double covering is uniquely defined up to unique as a morphism, but because I redefine it by the force of such splitting. And one way to see this object is as follows. Or to think to a double covering of the Adele, I have the finite Adelic story, I have the real story. In both cases, I have an orphan of double covering. And to give such an Adelic double covering is the same as to give a law which attaches to each Adelic double covering a real double covering. And if I use the so it's a functor, so here I have the flipping automorphism of the two sheets, and it has to give me the flipping automorphism of the two sheets. And the sum of the two, of something and its image, divided by a diagonal z mod 2, is the double covering of the Adel. So it's the same to give a Adelic double covering with this splitting, or to give such a functor. The other thing I have to observe is that if I take V of dimension 1 over C, I can view it as being of dimension 2 over the reals. And now here, to give myself a double covering, is the same thing here to give a square root of this line. So a square root of a line is not a line, out of vector space of dimension 1 with an isomorphism of its tensor square with V. To give this for a one-dimensional complex vector space is the same as to give a double covering of the underlying real vector space. Just you have W going to W tensor 2 to give the covering map. Now, with those preliminaries, I can describe the story over the complex. So I give myself an elliptic curve, and to it I can attach its Lie algebra, complex vector space of dimension 1. For each prime p, I can look at the projective limit of the e p nth even point, so that's the tet module tp of e, and I will prefer to look at vp of e, which is the corresponding vector space over the p-adic. Both Lie algebra and this VP of E are invariant by isogenies. That's what they are good for. And now, if I am over C, I have the homology of the elliptic curve. The curve is its Lie algebra modulo H1 of E. And using this transcendental data, I see that Lie of E is H1 of E tensor R, and those are just H1 of E tensor QP. So I have the situation I was explaining before. If I take Raffanel homology, I have a two-dimensional Raffanel vector space. If I tensor with R, I get this. And if I tensor with QP, I get this. So I have a canonical double covering of the Adelic object corresponding to this. meaning that you have, yes, and taking a product E, one get the V adelic of E. So using this Raffanel lattice, one gets that a double covering of V adelic of E defined for me a double covering of the Lie algebra viewed as a real vector space, or the same, it defined for me a square root of the Lie algebra viewed as a complex one-dimensional vector space. So, and then when one has this over the complex, one can tell what half-integral weight modular forms are. Essentially, because if you have an elliptic curve, you give yourself a level structure and you give yourself a double covering of the V adelic of E, so this restricted product of all Vp of A, to which you attach a square root of the Lie algebra, and then you can repeat the definition of modular form, but now with half integral weight. So modular form of half integral weight is a law with two an elliptic curve, a double covering of the this V A of E tilde, and a level structure attached a section of omega of Lie algebra tensor minus k, where k can be an half integer because this square root of the Lie algebra is defined by this choice of a double covering. So this is over the complex number. And we want to do something like this in general. So it's not obvious, because the basic fact about elliptic curve is that you have all those approximations of the integral homology or cohomology. You have the Lie algebra, you have the Durham cohomology, you have those state modules. All of those are substitute to non-existing integral cohomology. And you want still that the elliptic curve somewhat remember this integral cohomology. So I will first tell things in a wrong way. I will have to correct it. So the wrong statement would be that if an elliptic curve, say, over a field of characteristic zero, to simplify, there exists a law which to each double covering of the adelic attach for me a square root of the Lie algebra, and in a way compatible with its advenies. This VA is invariant by its adveni, the Lie algebra also, if I suppose characteristic zero. So it makes sense to ask this functor to be compatible with its advenis. Now, this is almost true, except it has to be twisted somewhat. So the twist is the following. In the same way that an elliptic curve defines for me Lie algebra and a tête module, one has the same thing for the multiplicative group. So if I look at Vm, Lie algebra is just something trivial, one-dimensional standard vector space, and then one has the tête module Zp of 1, which is the projective limit of entropy of unity, and one will describe by twisting k the tensor product by the respective toes of those objects. So instead of looking at V adelic of E, I need to take its twist by minus one, so to tensor with the dual of those objects. And then the story is true. Twist makes nothing here. So my claim is that an elliptic curve somewhat remembers that over C it had an integral homology, in that one still has a functor which to this adelic finite adelic object twisted, a double covering of it gives me a square root of the Lie algebra, and with this one can make purely algebraic sense of the notion of automorphic form of half integral weight.
What did you refer B sub A?
I would have written finite adels.
Finite.
Yes. Morally, adelic would be both toes and the Lie algebra, putting all together. And then I have one double covering, simply. So, to explain how things go, I would explain first what double coverings are, or coverings. I was making you believe that if I have a two-dimensional vector space over QP, I have a natural notion of double covering. This requires some explanation. Now, I know two ways of doing it, Hilbert and Laubert. So I will make the pedestrian way and try to remember what I have over the real. So I have the plane minus zero and I have this double covering. And now I also have the same story over any field k and removing zero. And instead of, it's no good to use just double covering. I want to use covering with a structural group, which I will call lambda. That's a bad notation, but so lambda is a Abelian group. And I want to define what is a lambda covering. So in the topological case, it would be a covering and lambda permuting transitively the fields. Now, so I want to define over, for any field, what is a lambda covering. Over the real, what you can tell, if you want to be just algebraic, if you have a covering, if you have a line which does not go through zero, then the covering splits over it, because the line is simply connected. Now, you take this as data. So you want to have first something which is just a theoretical, which is a map, lambda acting, and simply transitively on each fiber, which will be the covering. But the additional data is that if you take any line not going through zero, so it's a full affine line, over it, the covering splits. So it becomes the sum of two sections, or of a family of sections parametrized on which permuted by lambda. Now, there are many too many of those objects. And then you ask one additional property. If you take G in GL of my vector space, if you have one such gadget, so a lambda covering with trivialization above each line, you can get another one by moving it by G, and you want that it G, you don't change the isomorphism class. So So you want an isomorphism class of Gadvet like this, invariant by Akhmanov GLV. And now too, they have a nice classification. So that's my definition of lambda covering with this homogeneity imposed. Yes, and it's kind of clear this is really taming the story because if you have such a lambda covering by the same recipe as before, it will give you a central extent of GLV by lambda. An element of this central extension is an element V and a lifting of its action to the covering. And at least for SLV, we kind of understand well the central extension of SL by some abelian group lambda. But one can do things much more concretely than going via the group. And so the theorem is classification of those covering that their isomorphism class corresponds one to one to homomorphism of K to K to lambda. And at least to describe the map is easy. So you have your V, choose a coordinate system. Take two elements in K, and now you can draw a rectangle. And you have here four lines, none of which is going through zero. And the data you gave in the definition of covering is that on each of those lines, the covering splits. So you can make parallel transport along such a line. So you start here, you move by parallel transport, and you move, and you move, and you get some monodromy. And you tell that AB is equal to this monodromy. Now, I have used some axes to make this definition, but because I have assumed homogeneity by GLV, it will be independent of the axis. So to a covering in this sense, I have attached a map K multiplicative to lambda. Now, it's easy to see that this map is bimultiplicative. You look at those two rectangles. So this is the rectangle where you go from 1 to A and from 1 to B. Here you go from not the same B, sorry. I would say A prime. Now, the monodromy along this rectangle is the same as the monodromy for this B and A prime, because I can, by an element of GLV, transform this rectangle into the rectangle where E I have A prime. So if I use that, this long monodromy is the composite of this fourth one and the other one, I obtain that A prime B equals A B A prime B. In the same way, if you use two rectangle put like this, you obtain multiplicativity in B, and also flipping, you see easily that AB is BA inverse. What is a little more tricky is to check that A, 1 minus A is trivial. But once you have shown this, you have shown that to a covering you attach a map from k2 of the field to lambda. And then there is also the somewhat more tricky part of showing. It's not too difficult that to see that it determines the isomorphism class, and also any map gives you a double covering. So that's what double coverings are. Yes, and now, of course, I want to apply this to QP, for instance, but if I just take the abstract story, forgetting completely the topology, K2 of QP is something terrible. So I want to remember the topology also, to have in the same time a topological covering. And here I want to have a locally constant symbols, and the two again will match. Yes, and so what one has to know now is that this continuous K2 of QP is equal to the group of roots of unity contained in QP, which maps to plus of minus 1 by raising to the power P man half this, raising at some power, you go from this covering to just plus of minus 1. And those are the double. And also then you have to know, so it means that here, as we will use the double covering related to Hilbert symbol using 2. And the story I was telling about Q, that the covering splits over the Raffenel point, is the reciprocity law that the product of those for all places is equal to 1. One understands what one wants to do. It still remains to show the existence of this construction of a double covering if one is over an elliptic curve over any field. And the proof is not the one I would have liked. I have no direct construction, but the method is first to understand what one wants to have for a tate curve, so the analog in algebraic geometry of the multiplicative modulo Q at the power Z. And there one managed to define everything one wants. And there is, so the defining the covering one wants to get is easy. And one sees there why one had to make this dead twist. One also wants to understand behavior by isogenies. And this is more subtle, because if you have an isogenies between tate curves, on the Lie algebra of tate curve is just trivial, just the field one is in. But an isogenies can give multiplication by n on the Lie algebra. And so you have to understand that the data of double coverings and gives you a way to extract the square root of n. And here you have to use Gauss sums, and to have a clean formula you have to use the sign of Gauss sums to see that everything fits nicely. Unfortunately, I would like to really understand the story of sign of Gauss sums from this point of view, but just I could do with source, it's nicer with, but I know way to go back. And now, when you have understood what happens at infinity, it's not too difficult to formulate the problem and to use that you have a solution over the complex number from the transcendental point of view and over the tate curve at infinity. And you have unicity of a solution compatible with all of that. So one proves that something exists and is unique, but one does not really construct it. So that's one thing which I am unhappy about. Another thing I am unhappy about is that essentially here I speak of things like theta of q, so it is some elephant qn square. But theta functions come usually with two variables, one on Poincaré per half plane and one on the elliptic curve. And I have no understanding of why half integral weight modular forms are at all related to theta function viewed as section of line bundle on elliptic curve. I would hopefully this would give a better way of understanding the story, but I don't know how to do it. So I will stop here.
I mean, the first thing you're unhappy about, isn't that familiar? Because spinners have that property. You can construct them canonically up to isomorphism, but you can't make a direct construction in ordinary geometry.
Yes, and here it's related to kind of spinorial construct and to...
You can't change
that. Yes, the double coverings on the adelic side somewhat appears naturally if you look at section of, you have all this work of Mumford when you have a double covering or in its metaplectic representation occurring. But I could not relate it with the story here. To see what? No, not at all. That I have, yes, I have explained two point of view on classical automorphic form. I did not speak of the third point of view, which is the automorphic one. And in this point of view, new form have no special property, so not at all. Ah, yes. So if you look at, then essentially you can still define fractional weight modular form by telling that you choose some nth root of Cz plus d at c power n in some reasonable way. But you have no notion of this fractional weight form being over a congruent subgroup. If you choose any lifting, to define this Cz plus d, you need to lift the congruent subgroup in this unupper covering of SL2R. And you can do it because it's free group. So a congruent subgroup will be a free group in a field generator. So there are plenty of lifting. So choose one. Now, move it by an element of GL2Q. So you get a smaller group on which the two will agree. This will not be congruence, usually. While in this half integral weight case, for the double covering, you have some nice lifting for which you never go out of congruent subgroup. So that's one aspect. The other aspect is that so you can define, using some nth root of Cz plus d, a notion of automorphic form, but it's essentially as bad as a modular form of integral weight for non-congruent subgroup. So you don't have reasonable control of the field where the Q expansion will be. You don't know the denominator will be bounded. You don't have things like Hecker operator. Here you have, because you have this adelic story, so it's more complicated Hecker operator because you need the double covering of GL2QP. But you have nothing like that for other kind of fractional weight. You could still take some double coset with the discrete group, but you have no understanding of what it will give you. Yes, I have not done it. Indeed, one would like Hilbert Blumenthal, I think, would be very similar. But of course, one would like Siegel also, for instance. And here I could be very down to earth describing what double covering are. With Siegel, I could not be so down to earth. I think what replaced a two-dimensional vector space minus zero would be a Lagrangian subspace plus an element in its maximal exterior power. And but to concretely describe double covering in a down-to-earth fashion, I could not. But then one should presumably remember the Harbaugh definition of coverings in this setting, that if you have something two-dimensional over a field, you remove zero, and then you can look. This as a scheme, you have the sheaf, the K2 sheaf, you look at this H1, and this is equal to Z. And then you can use this kind of game to define what double coverings are, or covering by K2, which is also a way to prove existence of a covering corresponding to a symbol.
Is there a particular, is there an example of a half integral form that has a particularly economical expression when described in this language?
Ah, yes. I can speak about eta. First thing, if you basic fact is that if you take x prime to 2 and 3, its square is congruent to 1 modulo 24. And using that, you can do a construction of this way. Suppose you have an elliptic curve. Then you can look at isomorphism between n division point and mu n times z mod n with determinant 1. Now it makes sense. And this is principle homogeneous over SL of mu n times z mod n. And now if I take n equals 12, I have a map from here, so let me put 12 to the 12 root of unity. So this SL to Z made abelian is Z mod 12, but if one wants to be more canonical, one has this property. And now this means that to an elliptic curve, one can attach canonically a mu 12 torsor. One has En, which is a if one puts an isomorphism between the two, this will trivialize the torsor. If one changes by this 12 root of unity. Now, what happens is if I go to the double covering, rather, then I can go up to 24. So if I turn this SL to Z double covering, if I made it abelian, I get Z modulo 24 instead of Z mod 12. And one would think in terms of roots of unity, rather. And then one check that, so that's the finite adelic story, to give a double covering is equivalent to lift this mu 12 torsor into a mu 24 torsor. And so this I have explained purely in terms of story about the division point. But now one can view it also from the Lie algebra and section of Lie algebra point of view. So a nice description of this mu 12 torsor is as follows. You have the dual of the Lie algebra of the elliptic curve. you have its 12th power, and in it you have the discriminant delta. And now this mu 12 torsor is just the torsor of 12 root of delta in the dual of the Lie algebra. And then it's easy to see that to lift it to a 24 torsor is the same thing as to give a square root of omega. And inside this square root of omega, the 24th root will be the eta function. You can get something similar with the theta function. Not here I have used 2 and 3, but using only 2.
Almost like an algebraic group, even though it isn't, but it has consequences as if it was.
Yes, and also I think for me the very really strange fact, which one knows that an elliptic curve over any field, one cannot define its integral homology. And here one does goes a little bit in this way. So I was very worried to get a contradiction using a supersingular elliptic curve. And I don't understand exactly what happens, but I seem to have thought, of course, it's the Lie algebra of which I take a square root. Also, when I look at this viadelic and its double covering, I would remove the prime dividing the characteristic. So I have room to escape a contradiction, but still I remain a little worried. Oh, that's not algebraic anymore. Of course, GLN, yes, I was happy to look at VL2 because here I have a very nice description of this double covering, very concrete. For all the reductive group, one has classification of covering by K2. So that's how we know for symplectic group what happens. And I think in algebraic geometry it's important to have not just semi-simple group but reductive groups, like GL2 is more natural than SL2. So there is a whole theory of that, but more from the point of view of groups.